Hi, my name is TJ Welch, and welcome to episode number 56 of Sonic Lobotomy. And 56 was his number when he played football for Woburn High School. How about that? But these guys are they're from Lowell nowadays. They're moving up from the wonderful city of Lowell, the home of Jack Kerouac. On the Road, great book. If you haven't read it yet, read it. Anyway, this is local Boston rock, Sonic Lobotomy, and I'd like you to welcome the Fake Boys.
I care about you all. So miss the way that you smell in the morning. I'm not writing about you because I fucking love you. And I'm just calling to say I miss the way that you smell in the morning. As long as you're sleeping right here by my side. Sleeping right here by my side. I know in your head you're just waiting for me to get up. Sleeping right here by my side. I lay. As long as you're sleeping right here by my side. Sleeping right here by my side. I know in your head you're just waiting for me to get up. Sleeping right here by my side. I lay. We'll be right back.
One more time.
world is full of impossible dreams for
gone, and I'm gone, and I'm gone, and I'm gone, and I'm gone. So here we are with the Fake Boys from Lowell, Mass. Thanks, guys, for coming on the show.
Thanks for having us.
The performance was great.
Thank you.
Hey, it came out good. Your songs really sounded good. We got a nice balance between the three instruments and vocals. The way you guys sang, you know, you had some real good hooks in your songs.
Thank you.
And you got a good voice.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Believe it or not.
Yeah.
Well, I do believe it.
Yeah. How long you guys been
good.
Together?
7 years.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank God you're here.
Yeah, dude. Someone's got to remember.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So when'd you form? Were you in bands before then, or?
Yeah. We were in bands before that. We've been playing in bands our whole lives.
Yeah.
And then we met each other through music and.
When we were just little pups.
Pups. And when we started the band, we were both playing in hardcore bands. We played in a hardcore band together. You know, we knew each other pretty well, so it was like, I don't know, one day it just happened. It was just like, yo, we're starting a band. And he was like, yeah, we are. And
it just happened.
Just happened, you know.
Yeah, good. And has it been the same lineup for the duration of the band?
No, we started out with my friend Anthony, who played in, like, my first band ever, and he helped us out when we were writing our demo and stuff, but he couldn't really tour or really commit, so then we found a drummer who we had for a while. But we kind of pushed it to the max with him. We got the most we could get out of him. You know, he's just more of a standard pop punk drummer, and we couldn't really expand or play on the feels we wanted to write, or we couldn't really play what we wanted to play or what was in my head. So
yeah, a lot of the drumming that you do is got complicated turns to it. And
oh yeah,
strange turnaround.
Yeah. He's a complex man.
He's complex.
Yeah. Believe it or not,
he's American as fuck. Am I allowed to swear?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. He's American.
Yeah.
So we were searching because we wanted to do more, and some things came up, and we thought it would be a good time to go searching. One of my other buddies stepped in for a little bit, recorded a 7-inch, played some shows.
Went on tour with us.
He killed it, and then we found this dude's our perm.
And perm. Let's introduce you guys. Let's introduce you.
That's Keith.
Keith.
All right.
Introduce yourself.
Keith.
And he's a drummer.
That's
yeah.
Keith. Introduce me.
Jim.
Thank you.
Guitarist and singer.
Sometimes.
Ish.
Oh, that's Joe.
Hey.
He plays bass.
Play bass.
Yeah, so another trio, and you guys filled it up. Yeah, I'm TJ.
Teach!
Yeah. You guys filled it up nice for trio, you know, very,
I like to fill it up.
A lot happening. Yeah, you got to do that, you know, there's a lot of space.
Yeah.
When you don't have a lot of guys in your band, you know, it's a...
We try to write that way, and like the sound of the bass is kind of like filling in for like a rhythm guitar, where that would be.
Yeah, you use a distortion box on the bass.
Oh yeah, always.
So it fills in that
so then he can go off and play, you know, whatever he wants.
Yeah.
And I can kind of hold it down with the drums and...
Yeah. Comes together nicely. And you guys, one thing that I noticed about you is your gear is all like 70s era stuff. It's some pretty cool older.
We don't play.
Yeah, it's just, I mean, you get a certain sound with that old.
Definitely. Nice and raw.
Yeah, what did you have, like an Earth?
I have a Music Man, yeah. RD50 combo, and then that runs through the Earth.
Into a 412.
Into a 412, so I got the speaker coming out of my combo and the 412.
512.
And the,
512.
The 412 coming out of the cab, that's the Music Man run through, so the Earth's like in front of it as a preamp. I don't know. I played the Music Man like forever, and it's like the best thing. And then this dude calls me up one day, and he's just like, "Yo, you know, you can run the Music Man into the Earth, and
that's
then
how I talk?
And then you get like an extra set of preamp controls and shit." You
can, he's the techie guy.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
He knows all about amps and recording and everything.
I was pretty much like, fuck yeah.
Well, it sounded good. I mean, I took the time to mic both of them, and you'll be able to tell if it fills
yeah.
out.
Yeah, they're nice. You get a different sound out of both. Because one, you just get the raw combo, and the other one, you're getting the combo, but I can add a little bass to it, add a little more volume, take away some highs through that, you know, so it's nice. Thanks to this guy right here. He's a genius.
There genius.
He's the biggest piece of shit genius in the world.
Yeah. He certainly is.
I'm also a hobo.
A hobo.
Straight
right.
hobo. Yeah.
And you had a Sun Coliseum bass?
Yeah, Coliseum bass, and then two 118 cabs.
John Dupp.
From John Dupp, the man.
Yeah. Oh, man. Yeah,
love
so
Dupp.
John Dupp? He designs, he makes his own cabs?
No, he's just a guy in New Hampshire that I bought off.
He's an American. He's an American.
He's a collector, and yeah. he's very generous.
I did buy a bass guitar off you once a few
yeah.
years back.
Yeah, when we first met, you responded on Craigslist. I've gone through a lot of gear, bass gear and stuff, through the years, just trying to find the perfect tone that doesn't sound like I'm imitating something else and sounds uniquely the fake boys.
Find your own voice.
Exactly.
So you guys met on Craigslist?
Yeah.
Did you hook up?
Yeah, yeah. Casual encounters. Making sure.
Yeah, no.
Misconnections.
What was it? A Mesa Boogie?
That yeah, the 400 plus that I actually bought off of Keith's friend or something.
Yeah,
Keith got me that amp. And it was just too powerful, actually.
Yeah, you couldn't.
Which sounds ridiculous, but
it didn't sound good.
Because it was a tube amp, I wanted to crank it to get that real distorted tube, gnarly sound.
Yeah.
But then you couldn't hear anything else but bass. So I had to. The Sun Solid State works a lot better.
Yeah,
for our
it lends itself
situation.
To what you're trying to do, and
yep.
you got that.
I can crank it.
Bass that you know, just big fat.
Love that bass.
Yeah.
You sound like no other bassist I've recorded.
Hey, thanks.
You
know? Yeah. And the idea.
As your music is unique too. I mean, it's
it's out there.
Yeah,
it's pretty. It's far.
It's hard to nail down. That's
the only goal.
We think that would be a compliment, but most of the time that works against you.
Yeah. Well, to me, to my ears, it was sounded unlike most of the bands that I get in. You know, you have the hooks and whatnot and melody, but also you have odd turnarounds and you do some interesting things in your music. What are your influences? What's gotten you to this sound?
Hardcore.
Oh,
video games.
Video games.
Pizza. Yeah.
Pizza.
Negative Approach.
Negative Approach is awesome.
I'm glad
Canadian beer.
The Beatles.
Yeah.
The Ramones, The Beatles, Led Zeppelin, Black Sabbath, Blue Cheer. Great pop. I mean,
High on Fire.
Anything.
High on Fire.
I mean, anybody who writes solid melodies and anybody who can riff the fuck out.
Yeah.
I don't know. I've been playing music my whole life, and we all love great bands, not just a niche type of music. Like, we're not like punks or hardcore dudes who just like this or that.
Yeah.
Like,
just regular people
appreciate
that like music.
Individuals and appreciate when artists, you know, take the time to create their own sound and their own feel. And when we started this band, it's all we said, well, you know, we want to find our own sound. And if you listen to every record, you know, everything we ever recorded, it's been a progression like any other band. Like when I was a kid, you know, think of the Beatles, you think of those early Beatles records, those mid-Beatles records in the end. And in the end of the day, you look and you just see this journey they took you on.
But it's all the Beatles.
And it's all the Beatles. And the same thing with the Ramones, you know, it's all in how you grow, you know.
Buzzcocks.
And we just, Buzzcocks, man, like, we just wanted to have our own sound, we just wanted to be our own band, we wanted to have our own identity, and whether people like it or not really, truly isn't important to us.
You're satisfying yourself.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We're just writing our own favorite records at this point.
And then you've come out with a lot over the 7 years. How does someone get a hold of your music?
It's all free Bandcamp. On Bandcamp.
Bandcamp.
Thefakeboys.bandcamp.com or the other way around. I'm not really sure.
Fakeboys.gov.
Yeah, the .gov, yeah.
.gov.
Nowadays, it's, most of the bands I have on are, you know, the CDs, selling CDs isn't a reality anymore.
We haven't put out a CD in a while.
We haven't pressed a CD since, like, 2010, but we have vinyl. We have LPs. We got 3 full-length LPs out that
split
you can buy
inch.
Online.
Yeah.
Through our Facebook, I think there's a link.
Yeah.
And
the one we're recording now, you know, every aspect of the production and the recording, the engineering is all just for vinyl. And, you know, digital as well, but, I mean, vinyl's really what matters.
Yeah, people are coming back to vinyl. I've got 8,000 records in the next room. I know what you mean.
Right, it's just superior sound, you know, so.
And that's good. And it also lets you regulate your music and sell your music again.
Right.
Now that CDs are gone.
Right, right.
The new record. Let's talk about the latest record that you did. What studio did you go in to do it?
We recorded our last record with Jay Moss at Getaway Recordings. He's my boy.
Yeah.
And he kills it. He did everything up to this point, pretty much. But now our new drummer's, he's kind of a recording whiz. And he's
got his own studio in his house.
Labyrinth Recordings.
Labyrinth Audio.
Labyrinth Audio.
Ah.
He knows exactly what we want to do, so I feel like we might go with him. We with this next record. We haven't really decided yet. He's on the fence about it. We both want to go with Keith, but he doesn't believe in Keith.
Self-conscious.
He gets self-conscious sometimes. He looks like a big, you know,
cocksure dude.
But
right.
Hey, whatever.
He's like, you'd see the students be like, he's got a cock ring on 24/7,
and he's sure of it.
Like, you know your way around Pro Tools, and you get some nice.
Use Logic.
Yeah. I love Logic.
Whoa, buddy.
Favorite college class.
I use the software pretty much just to capture whatever and use it just, you know, pretty much as a tape machine.
Nice, yeah.
Just lay it down, and then if you need to do it again, then do it again.
He talks for hours about stuff. I have no idea what he's talking about, but he makes us sound good, so.
Yeah, that's nice. You save a lot of money when you do it like that.
Yeah.
I mean, Welch Boys did the basic tracks at Mad Oak.
Yeah, Mad Oak, yeah.
With Benny Grotto.
Benny, yeah.
You know, 50 bucks an hour.
B-Train.
You're into like $2,000 before you know it, so.
Yeah.
After we did the basics, we took it to Pro Tools up here and did everything else here, leads, vocals. Then we took it back to him to mix.
Yeah.
But in doing so, we saved a ton of money.
Right.
And if you can do it on your own, all the better. You have the luxury of spending all the time you want on a friggin' solo or whatever sound you got in your head.
Mm-hmm. It takes us a while to record.
Yeah.
We would go back to J Moss with the earlier records and, like, you know,
I just made it
would be done, and we would listen to it, and we would hear things that no one else on earth would ever hear in the record.
Yeah.
People would be like, yeah, it's perfect.
I'd be like, Jay, I gotta come over. I gotta fix this.
I gotta recut this.
He'd just be like, of course you do. And then I'd be like, right there. And he'd be like, what are you talking about? And I would make him like isolate the littlest thing. Be like, I gotta fix this. And he would just say, you're crazy. And I would say, I know.
Well, it's your music, you know? Exactly.
That was the same thing with the split.
Right.
I recorded the split. And I did about...
That was half Anderson, though. Come on.
Yeah, okay, yeah. But I did about 20... I did about 20 bounces.
Lay it down and leave it, right?
I'm not even joking. I did about 20 bounces.
Wow. Right. Tracking's no problem. Like, we track like crazy. Like, we just lay it down, one take, there it is, boom. Yeah. Like, we're well rehearsed. But when it comes to, like, the mixing part of it, we kind of baby it, you know? But I think you gotta, if you love it, you know?
Yeah.
Otherwise, you're gonna listen to it and regret something.
Right.
For the rest of your life.
I can go back to almost every album we've ever recorded, and I go, like, what did I do with this mix? Like, I should have did this, should have did that, you know? So, you know, whatever we're gonna do now, you know, we're not gonna regret it. We're gonna make sure it's exactly what we want before it comes out.
You mentioned a split. So you did some split vinyl with another band?
Oh, yeah, we've done a bunch. Yeah. We just put out one with our buddies Old Flings from North Carolina.
Asheville.
Yeah.
They're just... Matt Evans is hot. They're awesome.
Matt Evans.
Oh, he's so good looking.
Yeah, their frontman is the most gorgeous dude in all
of the
world.
Pretty good looking.
They're blown up. It's crazy.
Yeah.
But, yeah, we did a split with them on Bitter Melody. Great label. We've put out splits in the past. His splits are the best, you know?
Yeah.
They're real social.
Yeah, that's true. You know, and it's vinyl too. So
right.
You gotta love that.
Right.
And people buy vinyl, right? I mean.
Oh, of course.
Yeah. You can press 1,000, you know, you're gonna sell.
Yeah.
That's great.
You know, when you're on tour, it's the only thing that's gonna sell.
Yeah.
It's the only thing that's gonna put gas in your gas tank.
Besides your neon T-shirt design.
Besides your credit card.
Yeah.
The neon T-shirts work too.
Now you guys have done your share of the touring, right?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. We're pretty burnt out on that.
Yeah. Is it jump in the van and go out and conquer?
We used to think that was the only way you could actually get ahead, and that's what you're supposed to do when you're in a band and you play a lot of local shows, and then the next step is obviously go on the road and play all over the country. And I think there was a year that you made $0, right, on your taxes?
Yeah.
Literally $0. You can't hold a job and go on tour 8 months out of the year.
Just couldn't save enough money to do it for.
And if you don't have a booking agent and you don't have a million friends, you're doing everything yourself.
I had some great nights in some random places, and I have great friends all over the place, and I love playing to them.
I don't regret touring.
Right, we don't have any contacts, so it's like I can't book a tour and to go see my buddy Vic in Denver. It's hard enough to go see my buddies in like Rochester, New York.
Eight hour drive. You should be able to go on a weekend, but
we can't get booked.
We have to work full time jobs.
Yeah, we're
survive.
We're regular people, you know, and we don't have that in us. Like, we have no contact.
We got it out of our system.
Could care less, actually.
So you do what you can now.
And yeah. Well, we do what we want.
We just lock ourselves in practice space and jam.
Yeah, it's all about as long as we're writing music.
I think the three of us would be completely happy if we just
never played
had jobs that we didn't love but didn't hate for the rest of our lives and played in this band, just writing the same music until we're old and can't play anymore.
My ideal situation is to play one show a year. I would love eventually to just set up one show a year, like a Christmas time or something, and just have like two of my friends' bands play, like three bands total.
Yep.
Play for like 45 minutes. That's another thing too. You're on tour, you show up someplace, and you're playing like a, you know, nothing against it, but you play like a punk show, and you're gonna play 20 minutes. Anything over 20 minutes, everyone's fucking bored. It's like, to some of our songs now are like, you know,
six minutes.
Yeah. I don't want to play 20 minutes. If I set up, I want
to
play for.
We drove across the country to come here and play.
You know, it's just I don't agree with
people's attention.
I don't agree with that stuff anymore. Everyone's attention span is just get chopped down. And you know, I was there too, but I'm currently trying to reverse that because I don't think it's healthy. Cool. I mean, it's some of my favorite bands, you know, what if I put on the White Album and I got bored after a minute 30 of every song, like,
I know, the internet has kind of diminished all of humanity's attention span, hasn't it? And you guys, the good thing that I heard in your sound is, you know, your songs have structures, not just verse, chorus. Yeah. You know, you got a groove in the middle of a song or something. Right. Song goes in an unexpected direction, takes a strange time signature.
No third verses either,
which we try to keep two verse minimum, but have the songs can go as long as they want. But it's got to be a journey. It's got to change, and every part
up
has to fit. The most important thing to us, I think, is transitions. I hate bands who just write parts. This part, this part, this part, this part, this part. It's like, who can't do that and memorize it? But if you can write clever transitions, then your parts can be, you know, you have one over here, but if you can join them, they could be on two separate sides of the world. But if you can
join
write something
together.
That can bring it together, that's
put
to me that's
a puzzle.
Sign. That's the greatest thing for me. Like songwriting wise, it's all my favorite artists were the ones who could do those transitions.
I listened to Band on the Run the other day, that song, and I was just when I started to analyze the parts and how he fit them together, it just blew my mind. You know? Just amazing to fit that puzzle together.
Right. I feel like our new record was hugely inspired by years of touring, listening to the White Album, and listening to especially Happiness is a Warm Gun. And we like every morning put it on, and it was just like no part like repeats, and they all just fit, and they all flow.
Makes sense.
And at the end of the song, like the very last chord, and he holds that note, and it just felt so good. It just felt like you just completed something. Like, I don't even, it wasn't you doing it, but just listening it. It's like an orgasm every time or something.
That's what the
I'm asexual, but you know.
Gun. Yeah.
No, right, but it was just like the feeling of
I know what you mean.
Completion.
It is. It's a journey, that song. It takes you from Mother Superior and it takes you through different moods.
Right.
Queen, Bohemian Rhapsody.
Oh, that band is special too. Yeah. Queen, like we think of Queen a lot when we're making our new record, and I think one of the things that makes Queen so special, at least to me, is how
the live.
You could put on a Queen record and it's gorgeous and beautiful, and the way his vocals sit in with each other, and he can just sing on top of himself, creates this effect that's unbelievable. And then live, they were the heaviest. Punk as fuck, rock and roll band, and he was so good, such an entertainer, and the song live was not the same as the song on the record. There was a separate quality. It was the same song, they played the parts, but it was like
different feel.
Different feel, and to me, that's you got to be the whole package to really suck me in. Like, I don't want to watch a band sound exactly like the recording. Like, that just doesn't interest me. I go, why am I gonna get off my couch? I could be listening to the record, hanging out with my dog, but instead I'm here. But if it feels different and it feels alive, like the Queen Live Killers, it's like that's special. That's special.
I had the chance to see him back then, and with Billy Squire, like 83 at the Garden.
God, I'm jealous. Oh, really?
He'll be around again, right? And they never showed up. They never played.
It's not like he's going to die of AIDS or anything.
And it's not even like you have to add stuff to your record to make it special either, where it's like, with our record, it's not going to be anything except, you know, what we're playing pretty much, but it's how you produce the product. Now, you think about it, versus like someone like the Ramones, like, you could have the first three or four records where it's just pretty basic, guitar, bass, and drums, and live, they kind of play it the same, but they don't feel the same. The record still feels like a record. Yeah. They're great rock and roll records. They're not punk records. Those are great, if not the greatest rock and roll records ever made. And then live, even though it was still the same three chords, it was just something different. There was
no studio magic.
No studio magic. Even though they weren't adding shit, they weren't clogging up their record with all kinds of crazy instruments.
Production and whatever.
At least until End of the Century. But End of the Century was a
Phil Spector.
It was a Phil Spector record. So what do you expect? You know. But I still think End of the Century might be the Ramones' best group of songs they ever wrote. And I've learned to appreciate the record by saying, well, they did a record with Phil Spector. How do you think it's going to sound? But if you look at like live videos of some of those songs played in the era, played in like 79, 80, when they play like, for instance, Can't Make It On Time live, where it just sounds like it should be on Road to Ruin, you know, and that's amazing. But would it be as amazing if the record sounded like another Road to Ruin? Like, I love listening to it on End of the Century too. So that dichotomy, that difference there, it adds something to the
band.
And
that's what you guys are going for from record to record.
Right. Yeah.
And it was great to capture you live because it gave us a different sound than your record would have.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, we captured that phenomenon, that raw. Right. Maybe some of that interplay that you don't quite get in the studio.
Right.
You know, you guys
sticks breaking.
We try to like our recording process too. Like we try to keep it as real as possible too. Like when we track,
keep it real.
If we can do it in one, two takes, you know, that's the goal. Keep everything. You know, I double track my solos and everything. You know, I gotta hit them. But it's like I want to do it as good as possible, but also as raw as possible. So it's important to capture that raw quality. Like he told me once, he's like, you know, he goes, I'm not here to record bands or make records. He goes, I'm here to capture bands.
Yep.
You know, and that's how we want to capture that.
Yep.
But just on the record, you obviously wanna paint it and give it this body that you can't give it live. But then your live soul is like an equal trade-off as well, at least in my eyes. You gotta have both ends of the picture to prove you're a real band.
I really like the Cars, all right? But when I saw them in 79 or something, you know, they just sucked live.
Right.
So, I mean, the Cars will always be a half a band to me.
Yeah, you know? Right. Yeah, they, you know, they were good, but there are better bands in Boston.
Yeah. Yeah.
My dad was in better bands in Boston.
Your dad was in a band, huh?
My dad was in a couple bands. Too great. He was in PTL Club. They were the best Boston
hardcore. I remember PTL Club. I tried out for bass for them.
Did you really?
No shit.
Yeah, they had this big guy singing. Balls, yeah.
My dad.
That's his dad.
They were good, yeah.
My dad.
That was your dad?
Yeah, they're the best.
Oh, man. Yeah, they were good. How's he doing nowadays?
He's great. He's great.
They were in Woburn, right? Great.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, because I went over to Woburn like in 1983.
That's great.
Holy shit.
I didn't know how to play back then.
Right,
I still don't, actually. But
right, wow. I was probably there.
Yeah. Wow.
Running around with a poopy diaper.
They were the best. So it's like, you know, I heckle Frankie a little when he mentions SSD because that's just like, that's like child shit. Like,
that just
sucks. You know, like, I grew up listening to musicians play hardcore, like on a Bad Brains level. You know, I don't, like, they were the best. The only ones who could compete with them were Deep Wound.
Oh, Deep Wound from Western Mass.
Yeah,
I like them a lot.
Oh, and FU's. That's crazy.
FU's,
Jerry's Kids, Deep Wound, PTO Club. That's it.
That's my Boston hardcore.
Yeah.
Oh, he's just working and chilling and listening to records. Hell yeah. He's in a band called the Rag Rock Rebels.
Rag Rock Rebels.
Yeah.
They do originals.
So good.
Well, no, they do all covers, but they do them in
their own
style.
Yeah. So with Elvis wigs.
They take a cover and they put it through the creative process and they change it to this.
The cowboy hats.
Dark, country.
Rockabilly
goth,
type.
Rockabilly punk thing.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
It's cool.
What other band was your dad in?
Yeah, he was in a band called General Foods.
Oh, General, I've got their 45.
Oh, that's worth money, you know
yeah,
that, right?
Hold on to that.
Yeah.
It's got like the picture of the General.
Yeah, my dad. I've gotten I've gotten over $200 for that record like 3 or 4 times.
Wow. Because it went in General Foods.
Yeah.
In Woolburn.
Yeah. And they were, when it comes to like Boston Garage and stuff like that, like there were a lot of great bands. But they were the best. Just it is what it is.
It's a fact.
You know,
so science.
The real kids can bring it. You know, they're pretty close, but the neighborhoods might get all the credit, but I feel like General Foods was better than them. They just didn't put out enough material. They didn't have the... the opportunity, so I gotta plug my dad. But
and your dad's probably a good part of the reason why you're in a band.
Oh yeah, I grew up on like legitimately the first music I ever heard was the Ramones and the Buzzcocks.
Yeah, like, you said you were like 4 years old putting on.
Yeah, Dad, can you put on the Buzzcocks? You know, blah blah blah. Yeah. Or the like Nervous Eaters and La Peste and the Cramps I was listening to that stuff when I was like 5.
All right.
So I got really lucky.
Yeah,
has nothing to do with me. It has all have to do with my dad. So, in college, I did this paper and it was like, what's the most important thing your dad ever taught you? And I said, the Ramones.
All right.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
We can end there.
Yeah. What else can we say after that?
All right.
The most important thing you need to know.
Yeah.
The Ramones.
You know. Really, truly.
All right, guys. Well, thanks for coming on my show.
Hell yeah.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, we had a blast. Be good to each other and make good decisions. Love you.
And listen to the Ramones.
And Fake Boys. But you knew that.